What would you need to upgrade your current system to be capable of mixing in an immersive audio format like Dolby Atmos? And equally important, how does working in an object-based format like Dolby Atmos or Sony 360 Reality Audio fundamentally change the signal flow of your system compared to stereo, 5.1, or other strictly channel-based audio formats? Don't worry if none of that made sense, because that's what we're talking about in today's video. And by the end of this video, you'll understand exactly how it works. Thanks to RME for sponsoring this video and supporting audio education. To illustrate the signal flow of an immersive audio system, I'm going to be using a tool that I use all the time as a content creator, called Total Mix. It's the control software for my RME Fireface UCX2 audio interface and many of RME's audio interfaces. I constantly need to use custom routing for demonstrations, screen captures, and also in our live coaching community for Audio University members. Our live streaming events require special routing, and Total Mix is what allows me to set up mix minuses for live guests and to facilitate high quality mix reviews for members. For the purposes of this video, Total Mix is going to help us see that immersive audio routing on the physical layer is usually very straightforward and will be very familiar if you've got experience with stereo or 5.1 surround. By the way, you can learn more about becoming an Audio University member using the link in the description below the video. A typical stereo setup might look like this, with a line level connection between the audio interface and each powered studio monitor. While an immersive 7.1.4 system would require use of more audio interface outputs. But in terms of physical cabling, the same principles apply. If I were going to use my interface to set up a 7.1.4 immersive system, I'd need 12 channels of audio output. My UCX2 only has 8 analog outputs, but if I connected the ADAT outs into a Farofish Pulse 8 digital converter, or any ADAT converter, I'd have enough output channels, and each of those channels would have their own room EQ and delay within Total Mix that could be used for system calibration. But within the computer software, between the DAW and the audio interface driver, there's a new additional software component that must be inserted. And there are a few different ways this happens, depending on the DAW you're using. See, in a channel-based format, a stereo or multi-channel wave file is delivered to the listener, containing the left, right channel, and any other additional channels. That file is then directly played on the listener's system. In these channel-based projects, audio engineers can develop a stereo field using various techniques like panning, phase, and time manipulation. The discrete audio channels are sent from the audio engineer's DAW to the audio interface driver, which routes each software output to the appropriate hardware output on the interface. At the end of the channel-based production process, the mastering engineer delivers a stereo or multi-channel wave to be delivered to the listener. It's a relatively straightforward process. On the other hand, object-based immersive formats allow audio engineers to make various components of a mix into objects, which can be placed and automated as desired in a 3D virtual space. Then, on the listener's end, the system will deliver the best mix based on the listener's playback system, whether it be an immersive speaker setup, a stereo speaker setup, or headphones. In order to make this workflow possible, there will be a need for a renderer for both the audio engineer and the listener. And that means the files that are to be played back need to contain not only the audio, but also metadata that describes where each object should be placed in the virtual 3D space. When finished with a Dolby Atmos mix, production teams will export ADM files, which can be played through the renderers built into many home theater systems and streaming apps. It's important to understand this as an audio engineer, or even as an audio enthusiast. Object-based mixing opens the door for more immersive possibilities, but it's also mostly a black box, which reconstructs the mix on every playback. Therefore, your mix will be based on what comes out of the renderer, and that renderer is usually added by one of two methods during the production process. The first method is to use an external renderer, and the second is to use the internal renderer of the DAW you're working with, if your DAW has an internal renderer. Let's start with the external renderer setup, because it's educationally beneficial, even if you ultimately end up using the internal renderer. I'll be using Logic Pro to demonstrate this, as it has both an internal Dolby Atmos renderer and the ability to interface with the external Dolby Atmos renderer. The first step, if you choose to use the standalone Dolby renderer, is to purchase and download it. Or you can also get a free trial on Dolby's website. This download includes the renderer, an audio bridge that we will use to send audio to and from the renderer, as well as a music panner that we'll use to place objects in the virtual 3D space, and a few other tools I'll cover throughout the video. First, let's set up the renderer. I'll open Preferences, select Core Audio as the driver, set the audio input to be the Dolby Audio Bridge, and set the audio output to be my RME audio interface. Because we're using the external renderer, we need to create a sync connection between the DAW and the renderer, which we can do using LTC over audio with the LTC input channel set to 129. We'll return to this later on in the DAW. The output of the renderer connects to my audio interface driver. To set a physical audio interface output for each channel, I'll navigate to the Setup, Room Setup section and highlight the speakers I'm using under Speaker, and choose an audio interface output for each speaker under the Routing tab. As I create a new project in Logic, I'll select my interface as the audio input device and the Dolby Audio Bridge as the audio output device. The sample rate will be 48 kHz and the frame rate will be 24 frames per second. Next, I'll go to the Logic Preferences menu and ensure that the I/O buffer size is set to 1024. I've opened the template session that's included with the Dolby Atmos renderer download package. This session is already configured with 10 bed channels, 22 mono objects, and 16 stereo objects. To learn more about the difference between beds and objects, check out the Dolby Atmos mix setup walkthrough video linked in the description below. If we look at a template object, we can see that it includes the Dolby Atmos music panner. Inside the panner, we see that this track is already configured as object 11. The audio is sent to the renderer through the Dolby Audio Bridge, and the Dolby Music Panner sends the metadata for where that object should be placed. The same goes for each of these objects. With the respective stereo or mono music panner plugin already loaded and configured to map with the corresponding object in the renderer, we can test it by drawing in some automation with the music panner and observing the object motion throughout the 3D map within the renderer. You'll also notice that the timer in the renderer is synchronized with the timer in the DAW. That's thanks to the LTC settings from earlier, the sync button being engaged, and the fact that this DAW template contains an instrument track with the Dolby LTC plugin loaded, which is also included in the Dolby renderer download package. While using the integrated Dolby Atmos renderer within a DAW makes for a much more straightforward setup process, the signal flow and mixing workflow are essentially very similar. To use the integrated Dolby Atmos renderer within Logic Pro, I'll select my interface as both the audio input and the audio output when creating a new project. And I'll also select Dolby Atmos as the spatial audio format, and select a bed size of 7.1.2, or 10 channels. Within the session, first I'm going to create a bed track as an audio track with the output set to surround. From there, I can define an audio interface output for each output channel in the integrated renderer by navigating to the Logic Preferences menu and choosing each output under I/O assignments. The bed track can be routed to the channel-based 7.1.2 bed via the Logic Surround panner. This is useful for static elements that don't require an object. For the objects in the mix, we'll create a new audio track and set the track to output to 3D Object Panner. This panner works automatically with the integrated Dolby Atmos renderer, which can be adjusted here in the insert section of the master track. So right now, rather than the engineer and the DAW dictating the amount of each signal to be sent to each speaker channel, that responsibility is passed on to the renderer. The renderer either outputs through the external renderer audio output device or through the output device defined in the DAW when using the integrated renderer. In either case, my output device would be my Fireface UCX2 interface, which feeds the Farofish Pulse 8 via ADAT. Within TotalMix, I can send each of the software outputs to the respective hardware output. This speaker setup would be a big investment of time, energy, and money. It's a big investment, but immersive audio has a lot of potential, and I must emphasize that a real speaker system like this is the best way to mix in immersive. If you want help making sure your speakers are placed in the right position, download the Audio University Speaker Placement Guide for free using the link below the video at audiouniversityonline.com/speaker-placement-guide. But if you don't have access to mixing on an immersive speaker system, the best way to mix in immersive for you is probably through headphones, which only requires two outputs. This is possible with binaural audio. I can just connect my basic headphones to the headphone output of my laptop or my interface, whether it's my Fireface UCX2 or my more portable interface, the Babyface Pro FS. And through headphones, I can experience some version of my immersive mix. This is done by changing the renderer settings to binaural and choosing the correct audio output. But if you're mixing exclusively in headphones, there are some things you'll want to keep in mind. So you can check out the mixing in headphones video we made with RME in the past. Another really important part of an immersive signal flow is the system calibration section, which typically includes at least a corrective EQ and delay settings per speaker channel. The ability to adjust a delay setting for each output is necessary to ensure the sound from each speaker arrives at the listening position at the same time with optimal phase alignment. In addition to aligning the system in time, it's also recommended to use corrective EQ for every speaker. The room EQ can be used within TotalMix to correct for some of the inconsistencies caused by the studio monitors themselves and by their positioning in the space. Next, I want you to head over to audiouniversityonline.com/exam and take the Audio University exam. It's a fun way to test your audio knowledge and improve your knowledge in the process. In the next video that's on your screen now, we'll take a closer look into apps like TotalMix and other helpful features to look for when buying an audio interface, whether for immersive mixing or just stereo mixing. I'll see you there.